real city of the future. It's like a city with the fast forward button pressed down.
You could feel the energy, you know, it's just fantastic. It's lots of fun, lots of sun, and no tax.
It's very much a can-do attitude over here. Nobody else has got anything like it anywhere in the world, so if nobody else has got anything like it, we want it. Let's go ahead and do it.
Thirty years ago, Dubai was little more than a trading post in the Arabian Gulf. Today, it's the world's hottest real estate with a $50 billion price tag. And the address everyone desires is the Palm Jumeirah, a man-made island which is visible from space. With the market soaring into orbit, property agents like Paul McCutcheon are here to cash in.
Dubai used to be a desert. Look at it, what it's got planned. It's got plans for 800 hotels, 600 tower blocks, apartments, villas, Formula One track, football academies, three palm islands, a map of the world, 300 islands, the tallest tower in the world. It's just phenomenal. It's just like going to Disneyland every day coming here, I think.
When buying property here, there's one simple rule. If they've started building it, then it's probably already sold. Paul is at the front of the queue at the sale of yet another residential project. He's targeting apartments worth £150,000. They don't exist yet. You need a good imagination in Dubai.
We started queuing it 4:30 Friday afternoon for the launch or the registration at 8:30 the following morning. So that's quite a long stint, I think 20 hours. But to get apartments like this and be number one or two in the queue so you can get what you want, you've just got to do it and accept that you're going to be sat in the desert with a sleeping bag, keeping warm. And if you do that, you put in that sacrifice, 20 hours, you will get what you want. And hopefully I will get what I want. So I'm looking at that one. And that one, the fifth and sixth floor, which have a balcony starting here and go around, purely because it's got a view over the swimming pool and the river. And also this one over here, because that's got a view over the river and also over the garden area.
On one project, 7,000 villas sold in just 24 hours. Some can be bought and sold half a dozen times before the builders have started.
Dear me, look at all the people. There's about 200 or 300 people here, and they've only got 80 apartments to sell, I think. £30,000 deposit. Got to pay another £30,000 in June. Then we'll sell it and make £60,000. So I'll see what we do. It's not bad for a weekend's work.
Miles away on a construction site in Newcastle, the man in charge, Billy Todd, has just spent a small fortune on a villa in Dubai without ever having been there.
It is barren ground at the minute. It's basically a plot of sand, but the completion date is 2006. And hopefully, if they're not like the English builders, it might be on time.
The man who persuaded him to commit to a £250,000 investment was family friend and fellow Geordie, Paul McCutcheon.
So these are all different types of houses dotted around with a lake in the middle.
Yeah. And what are these? Are these parks? It's about.
These are just little parks that are, again, man-made.
Yeah.
So before this, all this is desert. Suddenly, you've got green grass flying out of the ground.
Yeah,
good stuff. It's quite nice.
Yeah. It is.
As well as lakes and canals. It won't be to everyone's taste, but the majority of people who are looking to the future and seeing what it's going to produce, I'm sure whether it be for investment, whether it be for moving there, living there.
You'd be floating in the town if there's any problems with it, I assure you. It's got to work. You've got to look at the pluses and the minuses, and there's just too much money involved for this to go wrong.
I mean, with the amount of people with the idea and what they're doing, the prices are still relatively cheap for what you can get out there.
Yes.
If it wasn't going to work, I don't think I'd be telling anyone, never mind family, friends, that
yes,
it wasn't going to work.
The mastermind of Dubai's transformation is His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum. Conscious that oil is running out, his ambition is to turn Dubai into the tourism capital of the world. His mantra is simple: build it and they will come. One of the biggest property development companies is government-owned Nakheel. The executive chairman, Sultan bin Sulaym, is the man responsible for the Palm Jumeirah.
The biggest challenge of this project really is that nobody ever built something like this in the past. So you cannot say, I'm going to see how they done it somewhere else and I'm going to do similar. Nobody have built this much in a reclaimed land with all the logistics and the coordination of all these contractors. And we're looking at how we can make this project unique.
So unique, they're building two more, because this one's already sold out.
Here we are at the beginning of the trunk, and that's where the highway from the main road comes into the Palm. That's where the bridge, the main bridge to the Palm, and all these are the intersections, which basically we have five lanes in and five lanes out, and these five lanes actually go into 10 lanes inside the trunk. The trunk is about 450 meter wide, and they go to make sure that, of course, we'll have a smooth traffic into the park.
Sort of wooden houses, and they look on pictures like it's like...
John and Heinke Felton bought an apartment on the Palm for £145,000 when the project was still on the drawing board. 2 years on, and the value has more than doubled. But the Feltons have no intention of selling their dream home.
This is the latest model, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, hope so.
With all the roads in place, which we didn't have before. You've seen a photograph in our kitchen, yeah. A poster.
Yeah.
So where are we going to live?
Where?
It is so exciting. Have you seen the swimming pool?
What?
The swimming pool, there's one swimming pool for every four buildings. And we have a swimming pool just there. And we have a fitness centre. So John can lose some.
When you finish.
Not over.
Where we're walking now, there was water. We used to be fishing in this area, and now there is construction and bridges and all that. So we use our imagination, but we use also good engineers to ensure that what we're building is something that is going to stay. The Dubai vision is you want to be the best in everything. We're not satisfied in Dubai of what we have now. We're not satisfied with what we are achieving now. We have to achieve better. We have to improve, always. And this vision is really filtering everywhere.
When we first heard that we had got a flat with a sea view and high up and everything that we could ever have wished for, it's just like winning the lottery.
And we must have bored people, I was going to say to hell, well, I'm going to say to hell, when we went home, because we just got this and nobody sort of understood it at that stage, because it was two, three years ago. Now people relate to it, but then they were all saying, you're buying something on an island that's being raised out of the sea, you must be mad.
And if your Nigel says he's happy, he must be happy, he must be happy.
Over there. with the bit on
crane,
it.
Yes, the tall crane there. I reckon that's probably where you live.
You can't, it still is a dream, isn't it? Living, actually going to live there next year.
I mean, it's a forest of cranes, amazing.
And the view, darling.
Yeah. I'm going to have
magic.
A photograph of that.
And we have a maid's room. Do you remember last time?
That's where you go when you're in the doghouse.
Yeah, I think I should spend all my time in the maid's room.
Billy and his wife Vivian have come to Dubai for the first time to see where they bought their new house.
What I'm doing today, I'm going to meet Billy, who we've got an apartment, a villa for.
meet him, take him up to where he's bought the villa, which he's never seen before, which is a place called the Arabian Ranches.
Look at there, look at all the cranes.
Home from home, is that what you see?
Yeah. A lorry full of steel and a couple of concrete wagons.
A couple of concrete wagons. Now you're not going to have us working here for
you. Got your hard hat in the case.
It'll be fantastic to show Billy because he has never been to Dubai, he's never seen this place. And in the UK, he does his business as a builder, so he's going to look at this development over here and either be fascinated or shocked.
When you think of cities being taken years and years to do, isn't it?
Maybe
50, 60 years, yeah. Mind-boggling, isn't it?
Oh, there's the Marks and Spencers. They're everywhere, aren't they?
Hello. Hiya, how are you doing?
You're okay.
Nice to see you.
Yep.
Cool, cool.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Well, this is
God,
the room,
man. Look at that. I've never been in this tower before.
Yeah.
So
well, it's a lovely hotel.
First time view.
Well, you know all this is the Palm, don't you?
I do.
Yeah. There's a lot of Brits here.
There's a lot of, I mean, there's 120,000 Brits live here.
Yeah.
And they're predicting that to be a million in no time.
And when did you see it to be complete? The whole job, was it?
The whole job, 2011, the whole lot.
And that's 10 million?
10 million people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dubai's drive to create a tourist paradise means ever larger and more lavish projects are in the pipeline, including this unique multi-themed shopping experience.
So this is the mall here, and you can see we are at the Andalusian court, and this is the Tunisian, this is the Egyptian, that is the Persian, the Indian, and the Chinese. We're gonna take this car, I think. This is Alhambra Court, and this is actually a replica of what Alhambra Court in Spain looks like. And that is the Fountain of the Lions, which was used at a time instrument by the Arabs in Spain, whereby each lion would squirt water every hour. And I tell you, this is worth all the headache and the effort that we put, and the challenges, and the sleepless nights that we have, and the fight we have with the engineers and everybody. When we finish it, this is satisfying. When you see that something that you worked very hard on, that you really brought it to reality, and this is very satisfying. I'll be more satisfied when all these shops open. And now we are entering Persia, and Persia is beautiful. You see, everywhere we go, it is something interesting. This is Debenham. They'll be open soon. We're not satisfied in Nakheel that we just build a shopping center. Anything we build has to be enjoyable for whoever lives or shops in it. And we wanted people to enjoy when they will go. It's not only the shop that's going to attract them, but actually the architecture. This, for example, one of the small bazaars in Iran that we introduced.
Billy and Vivian are on the way to their plot of sand. All they can see at the moment is a show home down the road.
Everyone works a 12-hour shift, so the builders work 24 hours. None of these plastics were here yesterday.
Mind-boggling, isn't it?
So it will be a bit hard for residents to start living here because it's still essentially a building site. The garden's all fitted out.
The gardens are fitted out.
That's where
you get
yeah.
something like that. That'd be nice. Oh, it's a good size, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's quite spacious.
See, there is a swimming pool involved as well.
Yeah.
You have to put that in yourself. Put your hat on.
All oh, right.
Yeah.
You just imagine yourself sitting out there with your knotted hanky on there, couldn't you? Your shorts. A few bottles of beer.
just the top of the stairs,
London,
isn't
yeah.
it? Oh, this is nice.
This is master bed.
Yeah. Beautiful. Oh, you can see the golf course.
Beautiful, yeah. Was this, are you sure this wasn't the one we were buying for, was it?
Shall we fight over who gets
yeah.
this one?
Yeah, come on, let's get it on.
Fabulous.
We've been just sitting out here.
We're so. Just sitting, double with eating.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's very impressive, isn't it?
Fantastic, it's fantastic, isn't it? Yeah.
The quality of fitness is unbelievable. It's
nice.
Pretty much what I thought from the brochure, exactly as it is. Small little pool, very tranquil. You're very impressed. I think Paul's done a good job.
Yeah, nice one, Paul.
New projects are launched every day. Too much is never enough, and the only requirement is to be a world first. Stealing the show at this conference is The Jewel, Dubai's answer to the Seven Wonders of the World, on a plot of sand six times the size of the City of London. Rebecca Gurnan is the architect of The Jewel.
I suppose the journey starts off in Egypt. In Egypt, we have the pyramids, the original size of the pyramids of Giza. We have Khafre, Khufu, Menkaure, which are the three pyramids. In our interpretation, the two larger pyramids will be hotels and the smaller pyramid will be residential. And then we have two temples that we're going to leave as their ruined state, the Temple of Luxor and the Temple of Karnak. So you can actually go and see the ruins also, so you get that whole experience.
Trevor Arnold hopes to build it.
What you have here, basically, are the pyramids of Giza in Egypt, which are full size. You've got Paris here, depicted with the Seine coming through it, Notre Dame, the Eiffel Tower, full size.
Venice is, all the transportation is purely by canal. We have the palazzos, which will be the main sort of hotels. We have St. Mark's Square, recreated exactly as it stands in Venice.
Full size.
And then next to Babylon, we have Petra. Petra's gonna be a challenge because we're trying to recreate the mountain of Petra.
Full size.
So there's a guy here from France, and he was a little bit miffed that we were redoing the Eiffel Tower. And then I was going to tell him that when we were designing it, we thought it would be a great thing to have to be able to go to Paris without the French, but I decided not to.
I mean, this is beautiful, and when people put something down like this on paper, it's very nice to have it down on paper. But of course, somebody's got to actually make it work. The buildings, you know, these pyramids are full size, they have to stand up. Can you imagine how much cement? And funnily enough, how much sand, and the sand that we got here, is no good. You got to import sand.
Why is that?
Because the quality of the sand isn't the right type of sand for mixing cement.
I mean, the overall concept is going to sort of follow all the way through, whereas in Paris you have the top Parisian boutiques. If you have a favourite pizza place in New York, you could find it in The Jewel.
This is absolutely crazy. This is just the way this town is at the moment. They've actually sold properties on this area here already. We haven't even completed the feasibility. It's very much a can-do attitude over here. There's nobody fighting behind the scenes, you know, no political agendas of people saying, no, we can't do that, or we'll get human rights people involved. And, you know, let's have a look at it. Is it a good idea? Yes, it's a good idea. OK, let's go ahead and do it.
John and Heinke are moving on to see perhaps the most ambitious development of all.
Unbelievable.
They're putting in the foundations of.
That's incredible.
Which country are they building, Jackie?
If I told you it's going to be Brazil, would you?
I would believe you. Right. Yes, yes. Brazil. Brazil's good.
It began with a most intriguing invitation. An invitation that requested my presence in Tokyo, Cairo, Paris, New York, and Rio de Janeiro. But the part that intrigued me the most was that it was for one evening only. An invitation to dream bigger than I ever thought possible. It was an invitation to the world.
It's the start of the world, is 4 kilometres offshore. Now, the area is going to cover 7 by 9 kilometres across, and it's 300 man-made islands in the shape of the world. Out here, we're not selling apartments, we're not selling villas, we're selling islands. The smallest island is, I think it's about 120,000 square feet, up to 450,000 square feet. What we deliver is the island.
No infrastructure, no.
Nothing.
Good gracious.
The prices range from $7.5 million up to about $35 million for an island.
Went to a party. I danced all night. I drank 16 beers and started up a fight.
Business and socialising go hand in hand in Dubai, and at every party there are agents busy chasing clients. Party host and property developer Andrew Lemon has been here for the last 7 years.
You know, the demand on property here is just phenomenal. For example, the first phase of the Meadows, which where I live, very sort of plain vanilla family homes. I call it Milton Keynes with palm trees. The first 500 villas sold in 45 minutes of being released on the market.
The dream that is Dubai can be seductive, but there's no escaping that this is in one of the most dangerous regions of the world.
We come out here, we have a great time. Yeah. Everything we see is fantastic. It's a different world. You're wrapped up in a little bubble here. But obviously when we go back home, we see on the news what's happening in Iraq and Bahrain and Saudi and stuff like that. I know last week there was a bomb in Qatar.
Yeah.
Is it ever likely to happen to spill over into Dubai?
I mean, it's a volatile area. It's a volatile area, and there's obviously issues, you know, within the region. It's a difficult question, but yeah, it is a potential problem. But I mean, there's bombs in Belfast, people buy in Dublin, yeah, there's bombs in London, yeah. Madrid, people buy in Spain. So unfortunately, you know, it is the way of the world.
About the threat of terrorism, so we have to ask that question. But you know, within the area as a whole, do you have any comment about that?
All I can say is that we don't have a history of that in this area.
Terrorism isn't the most popular topic of conversation in Dubai. Neither is the question of how much of the hype and promise will become a reality, and when they've built it, will they come?
Funky life, I've been told, all it glitters isn't that gold. No, gold is not reality, mama.
Like any boom market, there's going to be casualties. It's inevitable. I think they'll be in the middle sector. But that's all part of growth. I think the great thing with Dubai is that everybody who lives here is here to better their own life. And the greatest punishment you can suffer in Dubai is being sent away from Dubai.
Which is precisely the fate that now awaits the man behind the jewel, which has recently collapsed at a cost of millions to investors. Mr. Maz Akhtar is in jail for fraud and faces deportation. But nothing will tarnish the dream of Dubai.
In any boom economy, you're going to get scamsters, you're going to get crooks and villains. bees around the honeypot. Wherever there's money to be made, you will get con artists. So, you know, caveat emptor, you know, buyer beware, you have to be careful.
Monkey life, I've been told, all it glitters isn't that gold.
You're over here. So just to the left of those things with the red tops, yeah, the Miradors, so you've got the golf course all the way around.
That Formula One is, that's virtually just on the corner
that's
here.
That's just next door. Yeah. It's a stone throw, yeah. So you can more or less play polo here in the morning, then golf in the afternoon. The next day, F1 there. You could take your kids to the international school, which is going to be here.
Yeah.
What have they not thought about then, Paul?
What have they not thought about? A space launch pad.
So we need one of those, do we?
We need one of those. Yeah. Okay. Don't tell anyone. Yeah. Because
I want to build that one, okay? Geordie built.
Geordie built. Geordie built space station.
What do you
fantastic
think?
We're very impressed. Very impressed.
Well, it's nice because Billy will go back to effectively my hometown and be happy with what's happened here. So, and the thing he's bought is brilliant, the villa. It's the best one of the bunch. Yeah, so seeing the smile on his face was really good. That's the world out there.
So who's bought them there? Any celebrities bought
them? I know there was talk of Peter Savary. Yeah. Rod Stewart, mm-hmm. Elton John.
You couldn't be in a more exciting city on the planet than Dubai. It's incredible.
And beauty and tranquility and colour and...
In fact, that's the trouble with Dubai. You run out of adjectives. I wanna hold you, wanna hold you tight. Get
teenage kicks, rest through the night. Because Posh and Bex have bought one, haven't they?
Well, they've bought on the Palm Jumeirah with Rio Ferdinand.
Right.
And a few other footballers. Mm-hmm. But they bought the big 4-6. I wanna hold you, wanna hold you tight. Get teenage kicks, rest through the night.
Next time, His Excellency Mohammed Ali Alabbar, head of the world's largest real estate company, shows what it takes to become a Dubai billionaire.
Stop the politics. 1 week, you said 1 week. You take it, you leave it, we're gone. Tell him how late are we on the project? How late? He said, tell him, if you send me a legal letter, you want me to send you a legal letter for damages?